Good evening and welcome to our evangelistic series. This evening we're going to start song service with hymn number 158, Were You There?
Sometimes it
259, The Old Rugged Cross.
On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of loss.
And good evening to everyone. If you're happy to be in the house of the Lord, let me hear you say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
I would like to pause to welcome one and all to the opening night of our special evangelistic series. We are so happy that you have decided to join us. And so if you're watching online on whatever social media platform, we are so happy that you are here with us. And I want you to know that we're going to be here tomorrow morning, where we'll have another inspirational service beginning at 11 a.m. That is the divine service. The Sabbath school begins at 10 a.m. And then we will also reconvene at 7 p.m. for our special service. And so as we continue our service, let us all unite our voices as we sing our theme song. And we're going to use our theme song at every meeting. And the theme song is Jesus is Coming Again. Let us repeat that. Jesus is coming again.
Number 213.
hymn number 213, Jesus is Coming Again.
Lift up the trumpet and loud let it ring. Jesus is coming again. Cheer up, me pilgrims, be joyful and sing. Jesus is coming again. Coming again, coming again. Jesus is coming again.
Last verse.
Nations are angry, by this we do know, Jesus is coming again. Knowledge increases, men run to and fro, Jesus is coming again. Coming again, coming again, Jesus.
You now to join us wherever you are at this time as we seek the Lord and pray. Father in heaven, it is with grateful hearts that we come giving you thanks this evening for your goodness and for your care, for the mercy that you've showed to us during the past week. And as we gather here to thank you and to worship, we pray that your Holy Spirit would rest on each one within the sound of my voice. Wherever they are this time, we pray that you would be with them in a special way to give them the desires of their heart. Father, guide us and direct our path as we begin this evangelistic series. And as we come to you this evening, grant us the blessings that we stand in need of. Guide us now and keep us in a special way. Remember the speaker. Enlighten him, endow him with wisdom and with knowledge from on high. And may the words that is presented be the means of drawing us who are here in this auditorium and those who are listening online, of drawing us closer to you. Forgive us where we've fallen short, Father, present so that nothing prevent us or prayers from coming to you. And then, when life here on earth should come to a close and you come to gather your children home, may each of us here in this auditorium and those who are listening online be able to hail you with joy and gladness. For we ask all these blessings and favors in Jesus' worthy name and for his sake. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Please be seated. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. Remember how generous the Lord Jesus was? He was rich, but he became poor for our sake, but to make you rich out of his poverty. I'm going to ask the deacons to come forward, or the ushers, as we collect the offering. And the offering today will go towards the expenses of the evangelistic meeting campaign. And there are three ways in which you can give. Four, actually. If you're here in the sanctuary, you can put it in the receptacle as it comes around. Then you have Zelle. Our Zelle address is fortlauderdale7day@gmail.com. adventistgiving.org is another way. And you would select Fort Lauderdale Church and follow the instructions, or you may mail a check to the Fort Lauderdale Adventist Church at 850 West Davie Boulevard, Fort Lauderdale, Florida, 33315. It should be on your screen for those of you who are online. Okay, let us bow our heads. Our Father who art in heaven, we want to thank you for bringing us here safely to your house of worship, whereby we may be able to come to worship you, to give you the honor and the glory. Father, thank you for journeying mercies, and we ask that you will be with those who are on their way here. For those who are listening within the sound of my voice, be with each family represented, each person, Father. And as the offering is collected today, we pray that it will go to further your cause and to spread your gospel of your word. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
At each meeting, we will be having a special health nugget, and this evening, our health nugget will be coming to us from Sister Cadian Steele, and it will be a video presentation. So this time, let us watch this very important health nugget.
A pleasant good evening, everyone. Tonight, I will be looking briefly on the topic kidney disease and kidney health. The National Kidney Foundation recognizes March as National Kidney Month. March 14 was observed as World Kidney Day. The foundation is dedicated on raising awareness about kidney health and chronic kidney disease. This month, the foundation is advocating for kidney equity for all. In the United States, more than 37 million adults are estimated to have kidney disease, also known as chronic kidney disease, CKD. Approximately 90% of them don't know they have the disease. About one in every three adults in the U.S. are at risk for kidney disease. Some risk factors include diabetes, high blood pressure, heart disease, obesity, family history of kidney disease, and some autoimmune conditions, to name a few. Did you know that a sudden insult to the kidney can cause kidney failure, such as trauma, excessive blood loss, and toxicities? This is known as acute kidney injury. If not treated timely, can lead to CKD. Did you know that the kidney filters and return about 200 quarts of fluid every 24 hours, and approximately 2 quarts are eliminated from the body in the form of urine? Did you know Black or African American people are 4 times likely to develop CKD than white? Did you know 1 in every 3 adults with diabetes will develop CKD? Did you know one in every five adults with high blood pressure will develop CKD? Let's look at some function of the kidney. Our kidney works to balance water and electrolytes. It filters waste and toxin from the blood. It controls the production of red blood cells. It releases hormone that will help to regulate our blood pressure. It produces an active form of vitamin D that promotes strong bones. Tips on ensuring our longevity of our kidney. You can enhance your kidney health by adopting a balanced diet and modeling a healthy lifestyle. Staying hydrated, regular exercise, avoid smoking and excessive alcohol consumption, maintaining healthy weight, managing chronic conditions such as diabetes and high blood pressure, limit medication misuse, the overusing of non-prescription drugs. In closing, I would like to emphasize the mandate of the National Kidney Foundation. The National Kidney Foundation is revolutionizing the fight to save lives by eliminating preventable kidney diseases, accelerating innovation for the dignity of the patient's experience, and dismantling the structural inequity in kidney care, dialysis, and transplantation. I thank you so much.
Well, I'm sure we all enjoyed that inspirational health lecture. And each evening, I would like to give a gift to someone. So I'd like to give this beautiful gift entitled The Desire of Ages to someone special. So I'm wondering if someone can tell me what day of the month that our first guest speaker was born. That is Pastor Stephen Gates. So if you think you could just, you know, tell me which day of the month, not the month, but, you know, the date of the month. Okay, so just raise your hand and then take a guess. Huh? What is that? Anyone? 17th. The 17th of the month? Pastor Gates? Were you born on the 17th?
Yes, sir.
Okay, well, first of all, let us know which month it was.
January.
Okay, January. Okay, January. So we want to find the date in January. So, the 4th?
Close.
She said close. The 4th is close. The 5th?
Close.
Close. Huh? You said the 7th? Okay, the 7th?
Close.
Close. Okay. Okay, oh, sorry.
The 3rd?
Close.
Close. Okay, close, close. Okay. The 3rd, okay, in the back? The 6th? Okay, the 6th. So let us give her the book and a big round of applause. Let's put our hands together. She got the book, and the ushers will, you can come for the book, yes. Very good. Okay, so she was paying strict attention. So we now know the date, January 6th, and the year is mind your own business, okay? So we're not going to tell you the year. We're not going to tell you the year. But nevertheless, our special speaker for this evening is Pastor Stephen Gates. Pastor Stephen Gates. He was born in Gulfport, Mississippi, but he was raised in Chicago, Illinois. Pastor Gates is the product of Adventist Christian education from grade school all the way to graduate school. He has been a minister in the Seventh-day Adventist Church for 20 years. He's an ordained minister of the gospel, an evangelist who has traveled in many places of the world preaching the everlasting gospel of Jesus Christ. Currently, He's serving as the senior pastor for the Ephesus Seventh-day Adventist Church in West Palm Beach, Florida. And he's married to Stephanie Campbell Gates. And I can tell you, he is a powerful, energetic preacher of righteousness. And so I'm sure that God has given him a special message for us this evening. And as you know, all of the speakers for this particular series will be basing their sermon on the Word of God. And all of the sermon topics will emanate from the seven last sayings of Jesus on the cross. This particular weekend in Christendom, people are celebrating Easter. Today is known in many places as Good Friday. And of course, our Sunday will be a special day for the Christian world the entire weekend. And so he will be speaking to us this evening, our very first speaker. And his topic is Father, forgive them. Father, forgive them. This is an actual saying of Jesus from the cross. But just before he comes, our praise team will provide us with an item in song. Let us give them a hearty amen.
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 We thank the Lord for that word in song. Amen. Thank the Lord for the ministry of song, and we praise God for another Sabbath weekend. What an awesome God we serve. Amen. Old song says, angels bow before him, heaven and earth adore him. What an awesome and mighty and great God we serve. I am excited to be alive on today. I'm excited to be loved by Jesus on today. Amen. And I'm also excited to see you today. We have been blessed by grace, but also we've been spared by grace. And I praise God for allowing us to see this Sabbath weekend and also be a part of this evangelistic thrust. Amen. We praise God for the angel of this house, your illustrious pastor, Dr. Jeffrey Thompson, for the fine job that he is doing here. And I would ask that you would please join me in saluting your pastor at this time. We praise God for him, and we know that the Lord is using him in a marked fashion here, and you greatly appreciate the ministry of your first family. Amen. Amen. Also, we want to thank God for the leadership and members of this great church. I believe that this is the first church in Fort Lauderdale, if I'm not mistaken, and we thank God for keeping the fire going. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Well, my friends, I am delighted to have my brother on the platform with me, and I'm going to say a couple of quick words and let him preach. None other than Elder Winston Peart. It is so good to see him. Let's put our hands together for him. God bless you. Glad to have him here with us, and we praise God for him and his service in the kingdom of God. Well, my brothers and sisters, we have a short time to do what the Lord has called us to do. We're going to try our best to do it, and then we're going to take a seat. I would invite you to please take your Bibles in your hand and turn with me back to Luke chapter 23. And we're going to look at verses 32 to 34. Luke chapter 23. And we're going to look at verses 32 to 34. Luke chapter 23, verses 32 to 34. And the Bible states there were two others criminals led with him to be put to death. And when they had come to the place called Calvary, there they crucified him and the criminals, one on the right hand and the other on the left. But then the Bible says, then, someone shout out then Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. I'm going to read verse 34 one more time for emphasis' sake. The Bible says, then said Jesus, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. I want to talk a little while on the subject with your prayers, but most importantly, the Lord's help. When they go low, you go high. When they go low, you go high. Let's talk to the Lord before we talk to each other. Father, in Jesus' name, we're thankful for your grace, your kindness, and your mercy. We're thankful, Lord God, for the experience that we've had thus far in this service. Our souls have been lifted towards heaven, Lord. We have been challenged. We have been charged. And by your grace, you are changing us. Now, Father, we pray that you would please speak in this brief moment and even in the moments after when the second word is given. That, Master, that you would be exalted and that you would have thine own way. Speak, Lord, we pray, for your servants are listening. For it's in the powerful name of Jesus. Let everyone say amen and amen again. When they go low, you go high. Most of us recall the 2016 Democratic National Convention. We recall many of the speakers that stood behind that august podium on that particular night. But we remember our ex-former first lady by the name of Michelle Obama. Michelle Obama stood up on that given night behind that podium, and she echoed a catchphrase that we remember till today. The country was in disharmony at that time. People were on their political sides at that time. And everybody was vying for power at that time. And there was a temptation that many acquiesced to, that they ought to get on the level of the opposition. Michelle Obama stood behind that podium on that particular night, and she stated something that was unconventional for some and others unorthodox. She stated that when they go low, you go high. And she repeated herself again, when they go low, you go high. My brothers and my sisters, what Michelle Obama was simply charging us was simply this: you don't get down on the level of your opposition. You don't act like your opposition. You don't act like your enemies. You don't act like your haters. But what Michelle Obama was impressing upon us, that all of us should operate with some Christian restraint. I wish I had some help in him. She was impressing upon us that all of us, no matter how upset you get, no matter what the opposition has done to you, all of us should operate and be governed by Christian loving restraint. But my brothers and my sisters, as I sat there and I thought about Michelle Obama's riveting speech, I thought to myself that Michelle Obama was not the first person who stated, when they go low, you go high. But my brothers and sisters, 2,000 plus years ago, on a hill called Calvary, the carpenter Jesus, the Christ and Lord and Savior, exemplified that when they go low, you've got to go high. I wish I had some help in here tonight, my brothers and my sisters. Jesus, the Word that became flesh, Jesus, heaven's hero and earth's emancipator, showed us, my brothers and sisters, how we ought to respond when people go low on us. The Bible says, my brothers and sisters, that Jesus is led to Calvary and he is crucified between two thieves. Now, one thing that you've got to understand, my brothers and sisters, that crucifixion was not a light walk. Crucifixion, my brothers and sisters, was a painful ordeal. The Bible says, my brothers and sisters, that they took his hands and they nailed it to the cross. Historians say that those nails were 6 to 8 inches, but then they took a crown of thorns and they thrust those crown of thorns on his brow, which was 3 to 4 inches. But then, my brothers and my sisters, they put the cross in the ground and they put it in his groove. And Jesus at this time, my brothers and sisters, he really should have went low when they went low. Jesus should have really, really prayed down cursings from the Father and the wrath of God. But Jesus, my brothers and sisters, showed us that when they go low, you've got to go high. And my brothers and my sisters, I learned something about life, that you never understand the tenor of a Christian's Christianity until they go through some pain, until they go through some hurt, until they go through some ridicule. You never understand the tenor of someone's spirituality and Christianity until they deal with some pain. And Jesus teaches us, my brothers and sisters, on Mount Calvary, that even though when you're hurt, when people have turned their backs on you, you ought to go high when other people are going low. My brothers and sisters, where you may ask the question simply on tonight, preacher, how in the world can I go high when other people are going low? Jesus gives us three quick insights in this text, and I want to share with you that if you're going to practice Christian restraint on your job, if you're going to practice Christian restraint in your home, if you're going to practice Christian restraint amongst the hypocrites in the church, if you're going to go high when everybody's going low, you've got to have these three qualities. The first thing that Jesus said, if you're going to go high when people are going low, you've got to possess a heavenly connection. Let the church say heavenly connection. Let the church say heavenly connection. I want you to notice the Bible says they said, then Jesus said. But look what Jesus did, beloved, because Jesus really could have called down curses upon them. Jesus could have prayed a different prayer. But the Bible says the first word that Jesus said was Father. My God. Ah, look what Jesus said. The first word that Jesus said, it wasn't a curse word. The first word that Jesus said was Father. I like that, beloved brothers and sisters, because that word Father, that title Father, is a term of endearment, is a term of trust. It is a term of intimacy. It's a term of endearment. It is a term of trust. It is a term of intimacy. You got to understand that Jesus used this terminology all throughout the Gospel of Luke. When you notice in Luke chapter 10, verse 21, he called on the Father. When you notice, friends of mine, when he was teaching his disciples how to pray, he said, our Father, Luke chapter 11, verse 2, which art in heaven. When the cup was shaking in his hands in the garden of Gethsemane, he said, Father, if it's your will, let this cup pass from before me. He says, not my will, but thy will be done. Jesus lets us know, beloved brothers and sisters, that if he was Father in chapter 10, and if he was your Father in chapter 11, if he was your Father in chapter 22, he's still your Father in chapter 23. I got a dead house in here. If he was your Father in chapter 10, if he was your Father in chapter 11, he's your Father in chapter 23. He says, Father, Father, Father. It's a term of intimacy. It's a term of trust. It's a term of endearment. What Jesus was simply saying, he says, God, things are not going the way that I would have it to go in my life, but I still trust it. Is there anybody that still trusts the Lord today? Is there anybody that still trusts the Lord today? You may be going through your own crucifixion, but you still believe that you got a daddy. You may be going through your own crucifixion on your job, but you still believe that you got a father. You may have to go to the surgical unit, but you still believe that you've got a father. And I thank God, beloved, that in the midst of pain, Jesus says, you gotta call him Father. He says, Father, I know I'm in pain right now. I know I've got nails in my hands, and I've got nails in my feet, and there's pain all over my body, but I'm still going to keep my connection. I'm still going to trust it. The Bible lets us know in John chapter 15, it says, abide in me and I in you. The Bible says in John 16, verse 33, Jesus said, in this world you will have tribulation, but he said, in me you will have peace. You've got to know, beloved, that no matter what you're surrounded with, that if you've got a heavenly connection, you can get through anything. He said, Father, Father, Father. I like this, friends of mine, because as I contemplated on Jesus' connection, I thought about one of my good friends who has a daughter by the name of Aria. Aria has a close-knit, tight relationship with her daddy. And so one day, thank you, sir, one day, if I can get some volume on this mic here, one day, friends of mine, they were on their way to the doctor's office. And so Aria was in the car with her dad by herself. And so she was having a continuous conversation with her daddy. Her daddy was answering her back and forth, and she was answering her dad. And so they got to the doctor's office. And when they got to the doctor's office, Aria saw her dad talking to the registrar there. She saw her dad occupied with talking with somebody else. But Aria was not content. Aria said, I had a good conversation and a good connection with my daddy in the car, and I want to keep this connection in the doctor's office. And so what Aria did, Aria pulled the coattail of her daddy, and she said, Daddy, are you listening to Aria? Daddy, do you have your attention on Aria? And Aria kept on pulling the coattail of her daddy because she wanted that same connection. I thought about it as I was listening to that on the phone. I said, every last one of us, we ought to have a connection like that. We ought to have a connection that said, God, I'm not
not going to let you go. I know it's rough right now. I know it's dark right now. I know I'm hurt right now, but I'm going to keep my connection. Is there anybody that can help me preach today? Say, no matter what happens, no matter if I'm in the abyss of hell, no matter if I've got all the money in the bank, I'm going to keep my connection, Father. Jesus said, if you're going to stay high when others are going low, you got to keep your connection. You got to keep the connection between earth and heaven, unless you will curse somebody out, unless you will go and get your machete. You've got to possess a heavenly connection. Said, Father, Father, Father. But catch this, friends of mine. Not only did he possess, I'm almost through here, a heavenly connection, but friends of mine, I like the second movement of this simple statement. He possessed a heavenly disposition. Not only did he possess a heavenly connection, but he possessed a heavenly disposition. Look what the verse says. It says, Father, heavenly connection. It says, forgive them. What? He says, Father, forgive them. Now, my brothers and my sisters, Jesus, as I stated to you earlier, could have said many things at this juncture. He could have said, Father, kill them. See, some of y'all need to take your religious halo off tonight and put it by your side, because you done prayed some imprecatory prayers. That means, God, cut their legs off. Take the breath out of their body. I wish I had some help in it. Let the tires roll off the car. I know you're looking at me holy right now, but some of you can testify you done prayed some imprecatory prayers. But Jesus did not pray, my dear sister, an imprecatory prayer. Jesus prayed a forgiveness prayer. He said, Father, forgive them. I like that word forgive, because that word forgive means, God, dismiss what they have done. God, send it away. It means, God, I don't want you to hold on to it, but God, I want you to release it. Is there anybody that can help me preach on tonight? This is a challenging prayer, because Jesus is saying, God, don't hold it against them, but God, let them go free. And I like this disposition, because my brothers and sisters, this is the attitude of heaven. Is there anybody that can help me preach tonight? Because in Psalm 130, David says, oh Lord, if you would count iniquity, who in the world can stand? But David says in verse 4 of Psalm 130, he said, but there is forgiveness with you so that you may be feared. I thank God that God does not have a disposition like us. I thank God that God doesn't hold stuff against people. I wish I had some help in that. I thank God that God is not like church folk that don't know how to release some stuff. But God says, I'm going to let it go. My God, Jesus said I could hold on to it, but he says I'm going to model a heavenly disposition in the midst of pain. He says, Father, don't kill him, but Father, forgive them. You got to possess a heavenly disposition. You got to possess a heavenly connection. But lastly, the statement teaches us we've got to possess, if we're going to go high and not low, we've got to possess a heavenly perspective. I'm in the verse here. He says, Father, heavenly connection. Forgive them, heavenly disposition. For they don't know what they are doing. Oh, my God. Yes, they did, God. He says, Father, forgive them. For they don't know what they are doing. Now, I got a problem with this, you guys. I know some of y'all too holy for this, but can I just crawl in this simple statement here? I got a problem with this, because yes, they did, God. They knew they were lying against me. They knew they were talking about me. They knew they were sucking their teeth in Jamaican style against me. They knew what they were doing. I wish I had some help in it. Every last person that sinned against you, every last person that offended you, they knew what they, I wish I had some real folk in here. They knew what they were doing when they they tried to get you, get rid of your job. They knew what they doing. They were doing when they abused you. They knew what they were doing. How in the world, Jesus, can you say that the person that lied on me and betrayed me and broke my heart and divorced me, that they don't know what they're doing? How in the world, Jesus, can you say that that church member that knows Ellen White and knows all the Adventist hymns, that they did not know what they were doing? What? He says, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. So Jesus, I had to ask Jesus, what are you talking about? Because Jesus, when I look at the record, the Jews knew what they were doing when they betrayed you into the hands of the authorities. Jesus, when I look at the record, a Pilate knew what he was doing when he betrayed you into the hands of the mob, because his wife said, leave this man alone. Pilate knew what he was doing. Judas knew what he was doing when Judas betrayed him for 30 pieces of silver. I wish I had some closing helping him. The disciples knew what they were doing when they forsook Jesus and fled. Peter knew what he was doing when he stood up and denied the Lord 3 times. So how in the world, Jesus, could you pray that they don't know what they are doing? I had to go back into the Greek language of this verse, because this Greek word for know, it means oida, and oida simply means that they don't actually understand, that they don't actually realize who they messing with. My God, my God, my God. They don't actually understand. They don't actually realize who they are messing with. And it makes sense, beloved brothers and sisters, because sin will make you dumb as a box of rocks. Sin will dislocate your brain. I wish I had some help in that. Sin will make you think you're doing right and you're doing wrong. You're talking about somebody in church and you think you're right but you're doing wrong. You're criticizing somebody and you think you're right with your snooty self but you're doing wrong. Sin will dislocate your brain to the point where you think you're holy. You're holy and everybody's unrighteous in church, and so you talk about everybody because you think you know what you're doing, but you really don't know what you're doing. And what Jesus is simply saying, beloved brothers and sisters, that they are walking around blind, because sin has not only a dumbing effect, but sin has a blinding effect. I wish I had some help up in here. I've got Bible proof to prove it. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 2 verse 8 that they would not have crucified the Lord of glory unless they would have known who he was. And what Jesus was simply saying, they don't know who I really am. I wish I had some help in here tonight. They don't know that I am the Messiah. They don't know that I am the Lord. They don't know that I'm the Word that became flesh. I wish I had some help in here tonight. They don't know God. They are blind and ignorant. They are dumb. But I want to thank God tonight that Jesus prays for me when I am dumb. Is there anybody that's thankful tonight that he prays for you when you're unintelligent, when you're going to somebody's house that you ought not go to? Jesus prays for us when we're dumb. They don't know what they're doing. They don't know what they're doing. They're ignorant, God. They don't even understand who they're messing with. They're messing with their Savior. They're messing with their Lord. They're messing with their life giver. They don't know what they're doing. I thank God that Jesus prays for us. He prays for us when we're ignorant. He prays for us when we think we're going down the right path. I'm so thankful, beloved. He prays for you and I because he's got a heavenly perspective. The old song says he looked beyond my faults and he saw my need. Is there anybody that's thankful tonight that we serve a God that's got a heavenly perspective, that's got X-ray vision? Is there anybody that's thankful tonight that my God looks beyond the mess in my life, the iniquities in my life, the transgression? And he says, Father, forgive them. They're playing church, but they don't even know who they messing with. I could take their breath out their body while they're going to the wrong house, while they're politicking. They don't even know. They don't even understand who they messing with. So how can you stay high when other people are going low?
You got to have a heavenly perspective. You got to look at people through the eyes and lenses of pity. You got to look at people and say, they don't even understand the enormity, the gravity of what they're doing. And that'll help you pray. I remember in closing, I used to pastor a small church in my beginning years in ministry in a little place called Yazoo City, Mississippi. I had some mean members, Pastor. Mean, you know, church folk can be interesting. They don't know what they're doing. So I had this sister in my congregation who didn't like me. And to be honest with you, I ain't like her neither. Yeah. You pray for me. Amen. I'm praying for you too. I didn't like her neither. And so she made it known, I don't like that little short, loudmouth preacher. And I told the folk who told me, I don't like her neither, pray for me. And so I knew she didn't like me, but I remember what my ministerial director during that time told us. He said, when you find a sour saint in church, he said, turn him into a sweet saint. I knew she had been abused in several marriages. And I knew that hurt people hurt people. And so every Sabbath I would see her during the welcome period. I would step off the platform, shake hands, but I would go right towards her. When she would see me coming with my arms wide open, ready to hug her, she would do this. She would do this, indicating that she didn't want a hug from me, but I would grab her and press her close to me and hug me. And hug her. I did that for 2.5 years until I left that district. And people asked me, they said, you knew that she hated you. You knew that she didn't like you. How in the world could you love somebody that don't love you? I said, because I got a heavenly connection. I said, because I've got a heavenly disposition. I said, because I've got a heavenly perspective. I can look past all of that stuff, and I can love her because God has given me X-ray vision. God has helped me love somebody who don't love me. And beloved brothers and sisters, I thought about that experience because that's what Jesus wants you and I to do, because that's what he did for us. The Bible says, but God, Romans 5 verse 8, demonstrated his love towards us that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. He had X-ray vision. And my brothers and sisters, if you're going to go high and not lower, you've got to have the right perspective. You've got to have X-ray vision. Oh, Father, in Jesus' name, I thank you for the example of Jesus Christ in the midst of pain. I thank you, God, that through him we've learned that if we're going to exercise Christian loving restraint in the midst of hatred, we've got to have a heavenly connection. We've got to know that we've got a father, we've got a daddy that we can talk to and commit ourselves and our burdens to. We've got to know also, Father God, that that heavenly connection will furnish us a heavenly disposition. We will forgive people who don't deserve to be forgiven. We will have mercy on people who don't deserve to receive mercy. But Father God, that heavenly connection and that heavenly disposition will give us a heavenly perspective where we will stop being derailed by what we see. And Father, we'll pray for folk because we'll realize they're blind, they're dumb in the midst of their sin and their hurt. They don't know what they are doing. So Father, help us, Lord, when other people around us go low, help us to stay high because our Savior did, in the powerful name of Jesus. Amen. God bless you. That's my prayer.
A powerful to us this evening from Pastor Stephen Gates. We ought to put our hands together and let us give him a big, big, rousing round of applause. Glory to God in the highest. What a powerful first word. We're going to be going into our second word momentarily, but I would like to give this gift to someone who can tell me the favorite two Jamaican mangoes of our next speaker, which will be Evangelist Pierce. In other words, you're going to tell me what are the two mangoes in Jamaica that he loves the best. Just raise your hand and let me know. Okay, she said East Indian and Julie. She said you got one. Okay, so I want a combination. This is a combo. You know when you go to McDonald's, you get a combo. Okay, see Sister Beulah? East Indian, what's the other one? East Indian and Blackie. Okay, well, let's give it to Sister Beulah. And let's give her a round of applause. Okay, come for your book, Sister Beulah, The Desire of Ages. Okay, East Indian and Blackie. East Indian and Blackie. I need to get some Blackie one of these Sabbaths. Okay, thank you, thank you, thank you. And so I'm just going to tell you something about our second speaker tonight, who's going to be presenting the second word of Jesus from the cross. And of course, the second word of Jesus from the cross is, today you will be with me in paradise. Let us say it together. Today you will be with me in paradise. And so our second speaker is Evangelist Winston Peart, who was the founding speaker and director of Moment of Truth radio broadcast, which was aired on WAVS for over a decade. Currently, our illustrious speaker is the director of the Holy Ghost Wake Up Call Prayer and Evangelism platform. It's a powerful platform with speakers from all over the world. I've been on the platform. I've presented a sermon on that platform. Very, very powerful. He is also the head elder of the Margate Seventh-day Adventist Church. And for the past few years, he has been serving as a member of the executive committee for the Florida Conference of Seventh-day Adventists. Within the Florida Conference, we have over 70,000 members with approximately 300 churches. So he's on the steering committee that governs our conference here in the state of Florida. But just before he comes, we will be blessed with a special item in song coming to us from Brother Kevin Clark. Let's put our hands together for Brother Kevin, who will sing to the honor and glory of God. You can use
it. Happy Sabbath, everyone. It's good to be able to minister unto you guys. I hope and I pray that the songs that I sing to you touches your heart like it does to mine. Tears in his eyes saying, tell me this isn't so. For there was no one in heaven and no one on earth worthy to open the scroll. Then one of the elders said, John, don't you cry. This is all a part of the plan. And then in the center of God's glorious throne, hallelujah, there stood a lamb. And they sang, worthy, worthy
sing our crowns and praising his name. When he cried, "Are you worthy?" I can hear Jesus saying, "I am." Oh, praise God forever. There stood a Lamb. Now open your Bibles. Open your heart so it's clear. We're in the last days. He said he'll come quickly, so don't be surprised when he comes back to take us away. Now feeble excuses won't get very far when you find yourself at his throne. But if you know Jesus and he is your Lord, hallelujah, oh, you won't be alone. And we'll sing, "Worthy, worthy of honor and praise." We'll be casting our crowns and praising his name. When he says, "Are you worthy?" I can hear Jesus saying, "I am." Oh, praise God forever. There stood a Lamb, and we'll sing, "Worthy, worthy of honor and praise." We'll be casting our crowns and praise. Says, "Are you worthy?" I can hear Jesus saying, "I am." Oh, praise God forever. Praise God forever. Praise God forever. There's the
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. Worthy is the Lamb. Let me just recognize the men of the cloth, Dr. Thompson. Today is the day I agreed to preach in suicide. Coming after a man I have recognized came out of the womb preaching. But praise God for the word. What do you say? I came to do my little part. Amen. I just want to recognize everyone. I enjoy worshiping with you here at Fort Lauderdale. Amen. I'm happy to see Sister Linda. Amen. Praise the Lord. And I have a short message that I'd like to present. Let us pray. Father, give me victory over myself, so that as I lift up Jesus, may it be that even one soul is born for thy kingdom. I pray through the matchless name of Jesus. Amen. I'd like to apologize to all short men who wears a beard and maintains sideburns. As far as I knew, you were thieves. Well, that was my perception of you as a lad. You see, I had a little book when I was a little boy called Alibaba and the 40 Thieves. And on the front of that book, there were the thieves, and this is the way they looked. So when I was a little boy and I saw a short fellow, I would run, because in my mind, there goes a thief. I never recognized when I stuck my hand in the sugar jar, I was also a thief. My friends, thieves come in all forms today. If you're giving someone a 6 for a 9, hello, you are a thief. Arrive at work late every morning, is that you? And always skipping out before it's 5, thief. Cheating on your taxes. Some of us, we have never paid the right tax from the day we were born. How about robbing God? Today, people make a career out of scamming. When folks from the upper steal from our 401ks, they are rewarded with a golden parachute, millions of dollars to retire. But not so back then. You see, my friend, when a man was caught stealing, he would be crucified. So there he was on a cross beside the Savior. Tradition has it that his name was Dismas. Look at him, the public shame of his family. His peers, who probably went to the synagogue every Sabbath, shaking their heads, what a disgrace! Do you see his teacher from Sabbath school, his mother, his brother, his sisters, holding down their heads in shame, wanting him to live, yet hoping this nightmare would be quickly over? I wonder what thoughts must have flooded his mind as he peers into the dark chasm of debt that dreaded Friday. He looks at the man in the middle. There was something about this man. Only a look at Jesus. Blood streaming from his hands, feet, and brow. And yet he looks up and he asks Pastor Gates, Father, forgive them. What kind of a man is this? He's thinking about others, not about himself in this anguish as they're crucifying him. The other thief on the left says, if you are Christ, save thyself and save us. Do you hear the voice of Lucifer? What has this, all this church gotten you? Isn't that Caiaphas, your high priest over there, overseeing the proceedings? The same people who said, Hosanna to you, are now chanting, crucify him, save thyself, and follow me. It's the same lies he peddled since the morning star sang upon the face of the north. This thief, every intent he has was to escape. There was no remorse. Given another opportunity, and he would steal milk out of coffee. He believes he must work to save himself. The best opportunity to escape, he thought, was right beside him. He heard how Jesus walked upon water, turned water into wine, and freed a demoniac. Does it matter if we're all sent to hell? No, he wants to escape. Still being used by Lucifer, yet in the very presence of God. Aren't you the Christ? Save thyself and save us. Let me ask you, is Jesus helpless? Is he in some kind of a predicament? He wasn't a sinner yet tied up to rob hell and the grave. Unlimited power, omnipotence became powerless to give us power over sin. Wasn't a criminal, but tied up so we could be set free. Lifted on a cross, locked in a grave so we could be loose from the grips of hell. A predicament? He could have called 1,000 angels, but instead of himself to save, he surrendered to the great plan of salvation. Hallelujah, what a savior. But I say, don't go mocking guest us now. Aren't we like him? Many of us tofuing ourselves to heaven. Saved by works. Jesus was suspended between earth and sky, time and eternity, the shadow versus reality, hell and heaven, type met antitype. The devil was using the thief on the left while the Holy Spirit was speaking to the thief on the right to demonstrate God's amazing grace. Says Luke 23, verse 40. But the other, the thief on the right, rebuked him, saying, "Do you not even fear God?" Ladies and gentlemen, that's a sermon there. I'm going home. Do you see it? The Pharisees, the leaders, the priests, the pastor, the bishop, the pope, those who should have known better say, "Crucify him." And that old thief says, "Do you not fear God?" Sometimes we're so bent on evil, we are blinded by any glimmer of light. We will cut off our nose to spite our face. If my hex is going to heaven, I don't want to go. Hello? Sometimes we get so lost over church positions and titles, we will divide the church, trample on babes, leave our children in the wilderness, and murder the innocent with our tongues in the name of God to obtain power. And this thief, his words cry out to us, "Do you not fear God?" Seeing you're under the same condemnation. And we indeed justly, for we receive the due rewards of our deeds. We deserve to die for our lives of crime. We should do the time, but this man has done nothing. Don't miss this, the importance of choice. Here lies the microcosm of the old plan of salvation. Will I please self or surrender to God's amazing grace? Jesus, I am a thief. I deserve what's coming to me, but I'm begging you, sir, save me. Then he said, "Lord, remember me when you come in your kingdom." And Jesus said to him in verse 43 of Luke 23, "Assuredly I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise." Oh, glory, hallelujah. Won't you praise the Lord? He's mighty to save. He wasn't trying to save himself, but surrendered to be saved by Jesus. One thief saw a predicament of being tied up on a cross. The other realized he was wrapped up, tied up, and entangled with Jesus, and saw an opportunity of eternal salvation. Thou shalt be with me in paradise. He died that day. You see, he was saved from the penalty, but not from the consequences of sin. So let me ask you, when he died, did he go to heaven? Well, there it is in the Bible. Today thou shalt be with me in paradise. I find it necessary to address this. Well, Jesus could have carried him to heaven. What happens to us when we die? The Bible says the dead knows nothing, his thoughts perish. When God comes, they are resurrected. The Bible says the righteous in the first and the wicked in the second to be eternally damned. In Luke 24, the Bible tells us clearly, on the resurrection morning, that is Sunday, Jesus rose from the grave and Mary came and attempted to hug Jesus. Jesus says, "You can touch me, for I have not yet ascended to my Father." So, he didn't go to paradise on Friday. Hello? So what is the Bible saying when he says, "Today you shall be with me in paradise"? Jesus is saying, remember, there were no commas back there. Jesus is saying, "I am saying to you today, Friday, one day you will be with me in paradise." Amen? In other words, when I return, you, like the many other righteous who sleeps in the grave, will be forever with the Lord. What a mighty God we serve. The last thing he saw was a crucified Savior. The lamb slain, the next thing he saw when he's risen from the grave, many days, many years after, He sees Jesus coming in the clouds. So for all intents and purposes, to him it may appear as if it was the same day. Hello. I tell you, my friend, he cursed the day he was caught. But what a blessing it turned out to be. I tell you, my friend, sometimes we find ourselves in a mess, not recognizing it is a blessing. One of these days, we are going to praise God for that man who walked out of our lives. One of these days, we're going to thank God for the mess we found ourselves in. Because God was working something out in our lives. Perhaps you didn't expect to get hooked on drugs, alcohol, cigarette. Perhaps you were skipping church for a while, but now you find you have drifted far away. I want you to know, my friend, today, Jesus is saying to you, you can be with me in paradise. You know, a brother was walking in a neighborhood one day. You know, if there's one thing about thieves, they must have confidence. In fact, a thief must plan his way of escape before he attempts to enter in anywhere. Am I right or am I right? No, I'm not a thief, but I know that. And so he was walking through the neighborhood and he saw a house with a chimney. Notice there was no one around in the yard and the cars were gone and it is summertime. So he said to himself, you know what? Oh, that looks like a easy peasy. I'm going to go into that house. I'm going to enter through that chimney and I'm going to help myself to everything that is in that house. The night he went into the chimney and he looked around and no one was looking and he went head first. He's going down and everything felt fine. He's thinking, maybe I'm going to find a Rolex watch. Perhaps I'm going to see a big screen TV and I'm going to walk right through the front door. And he's going down and as he's going down, he recognizes it's getting a little bit tighter. You see, the folks who made the chimney made provision for folks like him. Because at the top of the chimney, it's wide, but as you go down, it gets more narrow. But now he's almost through, so might as well just, you know, force himself through it. But the more he went, the tighter it gets. And before long, he was stuck, caught. Now, he had a choice. Hello. By the way, this is a true story. I'm not making this thing up. In fact, it happened in California. It happened in three other countries when I did my research. One fellow decided that there is no way on earth folks in the community are going to come into this man's house and see him stuck in a chimney. He's going to try and get out and try it all night, try it all day, because the folks were away. And they came and found him dead. Another fellow, like the thief on the right, he recognized he was caught. He recognized that he was stuck. Tell you, my friend, sin is like that, you know. You never planned to go as far. You didn't plan to do all the things you are now doing. The picture that the devil paints of the Smirnoff bottle, you see it dancing in the glass. But the devil didn't show you the picture where you're going to be on the street side. Drunk and folks stepping over you. The devil didn't show you the picture when your family is going to walk out on you. When you saw her in those, that Coca-Cola shape. Hello, somebody. The devil says, one night. He didn't tell you that your wife is going to kick you out of the house and you're going to be in the streets and your children are going to be embarrassed over you. You just saw the pretty picture. And there he was, caught! Now, what are you going to do? The thief on the right says, I am not going to try to work and save myself. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to cry out for help. Yes, sir. Hello, somebody. I want you to know Jesus is right beside you. Are you hearing me, somebody? Perhaps you thought you would have gotten over this thing long ago. You thought you could have kicked the habit, but you are caught, gripped. But Jesus is right beside you. The thief on the right says, listen, I am a thief. I deserve the time. Jesus, save me. The fellow in California cried out, and folks outside heard. Can you imagine that morning when the fire truck came and everyone in the community came and looked and saw this fellow stuck his head in the chimney coming out? It was a disgrace. But you know what? He lived. He was saved. My friend, Jesus can help you. I don't know what's going on in your life right now. I don't know what's that thing that has hooked you and grabbed you and you know this thing is going to embarrass you. But I want you to know there is help in the name of Jesus. He's mighty to save. Yes. Jesus is saying to you, today, if you give me your hands, give me your heart, you will be with me in paradise. Do you want to be with Jesus in paradise? If you want to be with Jesus in paradise, let me see you stand to your feet. Praise be to God. Praise be to God. There is victory in the name of Jesus. Victory in the name of Jesus. Perhaps, my friend, our heads are bowed and our eyes closed. I'm going to pray for somebody this evening. I believe Jesus is the answer. You know, there's a 7 steps program and a 5 steps program. I want to introduce you to the Jesus program. The Jesus program works. Not yet given your life to Jesus, but you're in church this night and you didn't knew that before your mother knew your father. This evening was ordained as a day that you would give your life to Jesus. You're in church this evening. Perhaps you are listening online. You're listening to this program, and you know that I'm talking to you. Just type in the chat, I want Jesus. Just type in the chat, I want Jesus. And if you're in church tonight, our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed, I want you to just raise your hand. Praise God. Praise God. Just raise your hand. Raise your hand, and I will pray for you. In fact, I'm going to invite a more power-packed man to pray this prayer. I'm going to ask Dr. Thompson to pray this prayer for us. Thank you. Amen.
Let us lift our hearts to God in prayerful meditation. O divine, majestic, loving Heavenly Father, we pause on this beautiful Friday evening to thank you for Jesus. We thank you, Father, because we are so happy that as Christians, we serve a risen Savior. We serve a soon coming Savior. And so, Lord, tonight we want to give you thanks for the powerful preaching of Evangelist Gates. We want to give you thanks for the powerful preaching of Evangelist Pear. And even now in these closing moments, Lord, I just pray that you will have mercy on those individuals who had the power and the initiative and the courage to raise their hands. I pray that the angels in glory will record those hands and those decisions that were made for you tonight. Oh Lord, in the name of Jesus, I pray for those online
whose hearts were touched by the message of the plain practical preaching from these two servants. And Lord, I just pray that you will bring us back tomorrow morning at 11 a.m. when we will hear the third word. And then bring us back at tomorrow evening where we will continue this special evangelistic service. And then bring us back on Sunday evening for the grand finale. And so we give you thanks, we give you praise for the reassurance that there is power in the precious blood of Jesus. Bless us and bring us back, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Let everybody say hallelujah. 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 Amen. May God bless you. May God bless you tonight. And I think as we close, I think we have one more song from Kevin. Yes, we're going to listen to Kevin Clark one more time. He did an amazing job. Let's put our hands together for Kevin Clark. He has one more song as we bring our service to a close.
Man, we serve a risen Savior. And my friends, he's still in this world today. I'm not sure about you guys, but I know the Savior that I serve is a champion of love. Ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention? I want to introduce to you, in this corner of the good and the right, stands a champion robed in white. His height exceeds the heavens, his weight outweighs the world, his reach reaches everywhere, his age is evermore. And he is higher than the highest, he is greater than the great. No one will ever take his crown away. He's more mighty than the mightiest, and he reigns from above. Undefeated champion of love. He left his hometown to enter this arena, to wave his hand in victory for me. An angry crowd crucified this king who wore their crown, as they gladly watched my champion going down. But I will never count him out, for I'm a witness of the day he arose to retain that title, champion of love. And he is higher than the highest, he is greater than the great. No one will ever take God's crown away. He's more mighty than the mightiest, and he reigns from above. He is higher than the highest, he is greater. He is more mighty than the mightiest, and he reigns from above. He's the all-time undisputed, undefeated
the all-time undisputed, undefeated champion, the all-time undisputed, undefeated champion of love.
Well, let's put our hands together one more time. Let us all stand for the benediction. Now unto him who's able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before the presence of his glory, to the only wise God be dominion, glory, majesty, and power, forth and forevermore. Amen. Good night, and may God bless you.